plumbing comes from the main in the street. It comes under your yard. It comes into the house. You keep noticing that you're getting problems with your plumbing. And you find out, after the plumber coming in a couple of times and fixing things, that you've got dirt coming in. You've got a break between your main and your house. Of course, when the plumber comes in and puts new pipes, it's going to make things better. But for how long? That's as close of an analogy as I can get. Yes, stents do help for symptoms. Yes, bypass grafts do help for symptoms. Do they change the probability of dying? No. But we know what changes that. What changes the probability of dying? Lifestyle. Any comments? I know that even among my patient population, among my subscribers, that tends to create some anger and frustration. Anybody want to air it? Comment? Concern? Okay, thanks. So there's got to be a better way. And yes, there is, and we'll talk about it in just a minute. We'll skip over that. You've heard me make the comment about we're missing the vast majority of people that are at risk for heart attack and by doing a stress test. This was not me. I think this was Vanderbilt or Princeton. Sorry, they're all the same to me. So, do you recognize what this is? This is a heart. I mean, this is an artery. It's a cross-section. That's a nice, clean artery. This has got a little bit of plaque, a little bit more, 45% occlusion, 60%, 70%, 90% occlusion. You're only getting a little bit of blood through there. And this is the line. If you are over here, you have symptoms, and you'll have a positive stress test. If here, you're not going to have symptoms. 68% of heart attacks occur in this group. Why is that? These guys clearly are not at greater risk than these guys. Why is it so much? Why is it over two-thirds here? Well, think about it. Think about what I said earlier about diabetes and insulin resistance. Insulin resistance actually causes more damage on a population basis because there are dozens, maybe hundreds of us that have insulin resistance and don't know it for everyone that has full-blown diabetes. Same thing here. There are dozens and dozens of us over in this category for every one person over here. So, yeah, I mean, there's just so many more people in this area. That's where the heart attacks are occurring. So PC angiography, that's when you do have that positive stress test and they say, well, you know, you say, is that real? Is that a real problem? I saw a couple of things on your EKG when you know. Well, I didn't have any pain. Well, do you not want to look? Who's going to not want to look? So you go into the cath lab, and the first thing they do is stick this big needle in your groin. And yes, if it sounds like I'm trying to scare you to think twice about getting a cath lab or getting a stress test, I am. At least full disclosure, I'm trying to get you to think about that. There's too many of those being done too. Now, the first cardiac cath was done by mistake. It was done by Mason Soames. I think it was Cleveland Clinic, may have been Mayo. No, maybe Mayo, 1958. He was doing pediatric aortograms. They were looking at the aorta of kids to see if they had problems there. He got a little too far. The entry to the coronary arteries is very close to the aortic valve. It went in there. He got this great picture. The heart stopped beating. They were able to get it started again. So for most people, that'd be at least a bad day. He was very excited because look at the anatomy. And for sure, the anatomy is compelling. You see all of these, anybody not see these areas of plaque? So if you've got people having heart attacks and you see these kind of areas of plaque and you know how to stent them, that's exciting. Very definitive anatomy there, but it's definitive of what? It's definitive of having a plaque there, and unfortunately we've learned a lot more about the science of plaques. There is no such thing as a vulnerable plaque. I hope looking at these images help you understand, though, you look at that and you think, that's not nothing. That's scary looking in there. Your doc's not making this up. But that doesn't mean that it's not bad advice. So we'll go to coronary angiogram, cover that real quick. Like I said earlier, consider angiogram when that's an option. It's a good option. It's being found. The COURAGE trial and the Scott Hart trial both showed that it's better if you're going to go the standard route and just, hey doc, my uncle had a heart attack. Can we get a stress test? If you're going to go that route, at least get a CT angiogram as well. What will it show you? It'll show you more stuff than you find on the angiogram. What will that do? That'll get you to thinking about, I've got problems. You know, the next time you reach for the refrigerator door, you're going to get a picture of that plaque, and it's going to help motivate you to do something different from what you've done in the past. So the study showed it was, quote, non-inferior. Basically, it ended up meaning it's better. So don't just do the stress test alone. At least do stress test plus a CT angiogram.
Do you plan to make any changes as a direct result of being here?
Yes.
Can you describe one of them?
I'm probably not going to take something I was thinking of taking.
Medication-wise?
Yeah, medication. Okay. I take no medications now. I'm off 11 of them in the last 2 years.
Wow.
And so it's really benefited me what I've learned.
So you've adapted a healthy lifestyle.
Yeah, I'm fat adapted.
And I know you take your own personalized data. Have you influenced anyone else around you towards the same work you're doing for yourself?
I have tried. In one particular case, I have a friend that he said, I'm not doing that. And he just had a triple bypass 2 weeks ago.
Oh.
So he's just talking about diet now.